buying net worth to me is I'm buying a death benefit that's eventually going to come into my estate. Just like GE bought that on someone and said, oh, they're going to eventually die. Look, the Rockefellers have done this. They buy life insurance on every heir that benefits from the trust. That way, when that heir dies, it replenishes the trust.
Yeah.
So they don't have to go be risky. They don't have to try to invest that money to have it grow and beat inflation. Mm-hmm. They're using the death benefit to compensate for that. Money can be complicated. Let a nerd help you. We're here to demystify the complex nature of money by getting you answers from financial nerds and whiz kids. Welcome to Ask the Money Nerds, a weekly segment of the Wealth Labs podcast where we answer your most pressing money questions. Most people work and scrimp for 30 years to build net worth, often taking risk, delaying gratification, and hoping that one day, someday, they can finally enjoy life. Why build net worth if you can just buy it? Yeah, buy your net worth and then build your cash flow. It's the way to gain financial independence way faster, safer, and then, if you actually do retire, use the strategy I teach here to boost your cash flow with any lazy assets that don't kick off cash flow, those assets that have plenty of equity, but they're not doing enough for you. So, Chief of Staff Stova, here we are.
Let's go. Have you, I guess you just came back from the lake, right? You said you caught a fish.
I went fishing on the river, We did a little float tubing on the pond, which I only got a bite on the pond or a couple. Oh, I had one. Just didn't reel it all the way in. It was a little guy. I felt bad that he even was on the
just wanted
line,
him to
but
be
I caught
free.
A big fish on the river today.
What kind of fish?
A white fish. I caught a little tiny brown, too.
This might be a silly question, but is it a white fish because it just is white on the outside?
I don't know anything about fishing. I just go.
Okay, just go for
not
fun.
Very, yeah. I'm like,
everything I know about fishing is from my little brother, and I haven't done it for a while, so I'm learning vicariously, you know, through you vicariously.
Well, we're going to take you out on the pond fishing.
I'm excited about that. Okay, should we get into Stephen's question?
Let's do this.
Okay, it's a pretty short question. He says, cash flow banking is a great concept. Can you expound upon the concept of buying your net worth?
All right, so if people go to billionairesmethod.com, I have an entire chapter on this, and I get... like buying net worth, that sounds unfamiliar.
Yeah.
But what I'm actually talking about here is when you have a death benefit, most people think, oh, I've got to die to benefit. That sucks, by the way. Any plan where you have to die to benefit, not a good plan.
Yeah.
But there's ways that you can unlock other assets that aren't creating cash flow with your death benefit. My focus is on economic independence, which is creating enough recurring revenue or cash flow from assets or businesses that you don't have to deal with every single day to cover your basic expenses. So the emphasis is on cash flow. Too many people are accumulating and they're trying to build net worth over long periods of time through compound interest and through retirement accounts and mutual funds. And unfortunately, there's a lot of problems with that. Not only is it slow, it's dangerous because if the market doesn't perform at certain times, that's pretty detrimental to the person who's trying to retire. So I'm saying you buy this death benefit and then you create cash flow by acquiring assets. And look, I get it. Like a lot of us feel like we just don't have a lot of time to deal with our money and our finances, but things that we typically feel that way about don't really work out all that well, you know?
Totally.
So the emphasis is you don't have to become an active investor every day. I hate day trading. I don't think it really provides value in the world, but there's things like that that people are always working on. I'm saying just get a little bit more intentional up front to find assets that create cash flow. And then you just have to monitor them once you acquire them, whether that's a business or real estate or something that's known for cash flow. Life insurance has cash value. And for people that follow us with cashflowbanking.com, we're talking about overfunded whole life policies. I mean, they're not getting huge rates of return. They take a while before they start outperforming savings accounts and then they become really stable. So that cash value can then purchase cash flowing assets when the time's right. But the death benefit creates future benefits. So you've probably heard this one before, but I don't know if I've shared it here on the podcast. So have you heard me talk about non-qualified deferred compensation?
Yes.
Okay, so non-qualified just means it's not a government-qualified plan, like a 401k or an IRA or an RSP out of Canada. So it's not qualified, and it's deferred compensation because GE in the 1950s, they wanted to recruit really good talent so they could become number one or number two in every category that they were competing in. The way that they did that was they offered these executives pensions. They'd say, hey, if you come work here, then when you retire, we'll go ahead and, you know, give you a pension. But what they do is they buy life insurance on that person. And they'd use the cash value to supplement their retirement or sometimes pay for it if they didn't live that long or if they worked there for a long enough. But it usually didn't cover the whole thing. But when that person would die, the money would come back in tax-free to the company. GE, right? So they basically bought that net worth because their company was going to last longer than those executives, which it did.
Yeah.
So when you get a death benefit, let me just give a few examples of how that could be beneficial in the future.
Okay.
So when people have pensions, and people still have these sometimes, they're not as common as they used to be because mm-hmm. most things are retirement accounts now, like 401ks. But my dad was a coal miner, so he had a pension. You get all these options. Like one, you can take it in a lump sum, and sometimes they can roll that, and that's fine. Other times they have to take it and pay taxes, so they don't like just taking that all out at once. Then they have an option where they get the maximum cash flow every single month, but as soon as they die, it's gone, mm-hmm. right? No longer mm-hmm. pays. It'll pay all the way till if they live a really long time, but a lot of times people will take a lower option than that because if they die early, it'll still pay money to a surviving spouse for a certain amount of time.
Okay.
Or if you take an even lower amount, like 50%, it might go for a minimum number of 20 years or something mm-hmm. like that. That's almost like buying insurance.
Yeah.
Insurance that you don't know whether it's going to pay off or not because you don't know, are you going to die before whoever it's going to be, you know, left mm-hmm. behind to and those kind of things. So if you already have a death benefit, like because you have cash flow banking, the death benefit gives you permission to take the maximum out every single month.
Okay.
Knowing that when you die, that money comes in tax-free from your death benefit. So it's kind of a synergistic coordinated asset.
Mm-hmm.
I'll give a different example.
Okay. Before you do that, is there, so having policies on yourself, your spouse, do people do this for their children?
Yeah, you could do that.
Take policies out on.
But to really use the death benefit, it's more about the breadwinner first, whoever's making the most money.
Okay.
Or that has the, you know, pension or things like that. But mm-hmm. a lot of people don't have pensions. So what are the other options? This might not be the most efficient option, but I'm going to use it as a demonstration.
Okay.
So a mortgage is you're paying the bank money because they lent you money.
Right.
Let's say you've paid off your mortgage and now you've got this home that you can live in, which is awesome, but that home's not giving you any cash,
mm-hmm.
right? So if you want to make that cash flowing, you can use your death benefit as collateral and take what's called a reverse mortgage. Okay. The bank's now
explain
giving
that.
The bank's now giving you money, mm-hmm. either in a lump sum, tax-free because it's considered a loan, or monthly, but it's less than what it's worth, right? Because they're getting the asset. So mm-hmm. the death benefit can pay that off when you die, so the home's still free and clear. So mm-hmm. if you're married or you want to leave that to your heirs or something like that, it's again like a permission slip to unlock a lazy asset, mm-hmm. to unlock a non-cash flowing asset.
Are those pretty common, reverse mortgages?
They're actually pretty common, yeah, okay. but I think you have to be like in your 60s typically to do it. And I'm not really the one that technically works in this field. You know, some of our other money nerds like Tim Carden have helped people facilitate it. And
yeah.
for those that know a lot about reverse mortgages, sometimes people are very anti-reverse mortgage. So I'm using it conceptually, not saying that everyone should go out there and do this right now.
Yeah, just something to look into maybe.
Yeah, and it's tax-free and it turns that kind of dead asset into something.
Mm-hmm.
Another thing is, we've been taught, and you probably heard this, like you got to build, you know, the golden goose, right? You got to build the thing that just kicks off cash flow. So people try to build this net worth and then just live off the interest.
Mm-hmm.
The problem is that interest right now is really low because interest rates are really low.
Yeah.
So people are going, you know, I'm not getting the cash flow that I wanted in retirement. Well, if you have a death benefit, why not just spend 33% more because now you're going to spend down your principal, knowing that you have that death benefit as a backup plan.
Mm-hmm.
So if you live past a certain age, you can actually sell your death benefit. There's things called senior settlements, which is different than a viatical. So a viatical is people buying life insurance from people who are terminally ill.
Mm-hmm. Are you saying viatical?
Viatical, okay. Yeah. Viatical is someone's really sick. They're supposed to die within a certain period of time, and people will come in and buy the death benefit for a discount, but a lot more than the cash value, because they know that person's mm-hmm. going to die and they're going to collect on the money.
Yeah.
So those are not really a great deal for the person dying mm-hmm. necessarily. I'm saying that senior settlements would be, you're not terminally ill. You are in your later years, like over 70 years old, and you're selling your death benefit. Now, I don't think it would ever come to that, but I'm letting people know you have this backup plan if you accelerated and spend your assets too fast. I mean, the institutions love if you only live off your interest.
Right.
Because they still have the big chunk of your money and they're just mm-hmm. giving you a little bit, little tiny morsel of it every single month, and inflation over time, you're going, my purchasing power is going down in retirement, or if taxes go up, which they are very likely to go up.
Absolutely.
That starts to eat into that.
Mm-hmm.
So, and the trifecta is high inflation, which we could easily face right now, low interest rates, and high tax rates. If you have all three of those in retirement, it's a really tough situation. But if you have this death benefit mm-hmm. that you bought, you can kind of accelerate and pay those things down faster,
yeah.
having that as a backstop.
Okay.
So the net buying net worth to me is I'm buying a death benefit that's eventually going to come into my estate. Just like GE bought that on someone and said, oh, they're going to eventually die. Look, the Rockefellers have done this. They buy life insurance on every heir that benefits from the trust. That way, when that heir dies, it replenishes the trust.
Yeah.
So they don't have to go be risky. They don't have to try to invest that money to have it grow and beat inflation. Mm-hmm. They're using the death benefit to compensate for that.
Okay. So I know I'm kind of learning along with you a little bit on this. I know you've talked about it a lot and I've picked things up along the way, but so if someone's buying their net worth, is it something where they have to have their estate plan and everything figured out? What other things need to be in place for that money to be perpetuated?
It has to be permanent insurance that's going to be around one day longer than you. Because if you bought a term policy, only 1.1% of those ever pay out. So if it goes away, there's nothing to replenish what you did. So it has to, and that's why you want to take minimal risks. So there's policies like variable universal life policies that could have increased in costs over time. They can have volatility where the market goes down and you might, to keep that policy, you have to shovel more money into it. So you want something with high contractual guarantees to make this work that you can count on. Mm-hmm. It's a different concept because this whole notion of net worth as a main measurement, it's like, what if you have a bunch of net worth, but you can't turn that into cash flow? And that's kind of how people are being trained. Mm-hmm. Set money in a retirement plan and forget about it. Invest early, often, and always. And then one day, someday, you can retire and live off the interest. But that interest has not performed. So if someone has $1 million in their retirement account, they're on paper a millionaire, but they could be living like a pauper. Because maybe it's kicking off 3% interest. That's $30,000 a year taxable. Mm-hmm. So $30,000 after tax.
That's not very much.
It's not helping them out. And how much did they put in there to get to that point in the first place? So it's this system where people are putting a lot of funds in there and the markets are underperforming long term because of fees and volatility and companies going out of business and what people think of their average returns aren't actually translating into what the bottom line is. And I've written a lot of articles in Forbes about that and we've done videos on that they can check out. So my focus is don't worry about net worth, worry about cash flow. I let my net worth come through my death benefits because they'll be there in the future. They'll be there to replenish my trust and I'm just going to be able to spend my cash and I'm able to increase that cash flow. And you want to train yourself in cash flow along the way. Don't wait 30 years and then you're going, okay, now I'm supposed to be an expert on cash flow when I'm no longer employed. People aren't expert in it if they waited for 30 years and never really monitored it from their investments. Most people's cash flow comes from their W-2, comes from their job. But we've got to become better cash flow investors, which takes more effort.
Yeah,
it does.
And even, for myself and I think just the way that we've grown up in society, just what we've been taught, it requires an unlearning to learn, to monitor and have cash flow. You have to unlearn some habits and things that our parents taught us or, culture has passed down to us because it's not really emphasized unless, you grew up in a home that was running businesses or taught you about money. It's just accumulation in a lot of ways.
Right. And I think that, the game is really rigged against people in accumulation. The belief is if you set money aside, it's all about how much money you can put away, which usually means restricting lifestyle today.
Yeah.
It's about how much risk you're willing to take, which for far too many people are taking far too much risk. And there's this misnomer that people that are really wealthy are good at taking risk. No, they're really good at managing and mitigating risk and paying attention to it. And the third is, can you wait long enough for this thing to pay off? Because exponential growth or compounding interest doesn't look good over 2 years. It's going to slowly, it's the tortoise.
Yeah.
And then the next 10 years, it gets a little bit better because the money's reinvested. And then it's the last 10 years that it's supposed to be really good. But what happens if we have 2000 to 2002 where there's 3 years in a row where you've had losses? Or 2008 to 2010, 3 years in a row when you had losses? 2020 isn't off to an amazing start. We're throwing money at it to try to artificially hold it up. But eventually there's going to be a problem. And for those people that were counting on those years being positive, because most people look at it like as if they got 6, 7, or 8% every single year versus.
And that wasn't the reality.
Yeah. Well, let's say that the first year you lose 10% on $100,000. Now you're down to $90,000. And then you watch CNBC and they go, markets rallied. We're back up 10%. Well, you're not back to 100,000.
No,
you're at 99,000 because it's 10% of 90,000, and they didn't stop charging the fees. So you still had to pay your fees during that time, and you didn't have any cash flow. But rather than people trying to save 10% of their income and try to earn 10% of their income, which is really pretty risky, I'm more about how do we create enough cash flow to cover your entire expenses so that every time you earn an active dollar, either through your business that you're involved with or through your job, you can reinvest that to build more cash flowing assets. That accelerates very quickly and provides a completely different lifestyle. And then anything that you do pay off or any assets that you do gain and grow, use the death benefit as a way to unlock those. So billionairesmethod.com, there's a whole chapter on it.
Resource.
I think it's a great resource, and there's a cash flow banking course inside of that that people could upgrade to that has 42 videos, and six of those videos are just on how you utilize your death benefit while you're alive. So this is completely separate than cash flow. This is a advanced concept that major corporations have used for a long time and the wealthiest families have used for a long time. But for whatever reason, that advice didn't really trickle down, because when people are just trying to make ends meet, a lot of times just how do we reduce expenses to save something?
Yeah.
Instead of how do we create cash flow with assets? And that's why the game's rigged against people. I'd rather have them rig it in their favor. I mean, every time you make a deposit in a bank, they don't go put it in a retirement plan. They lend that out to create more cash flow. And they try to get collateral so that they protect that cash flow. They try to get a down payment so they have even more protection. They try to have an asset on this, you know, whether it's a car or a home, to protect themselves. And yet the average investor is being taught to do the opposite. Hand it over to the Wall Street person that's smarter than you. That's kind of the notion. And they may be really smart at what they do, but we're all smart at something.
Absolutely.
And if we invest in that and we learn how to make more money, as step one, then we learn how to keep more by saving on tax, saving on interest, saving on investment fees that don't help us, and saving on insurance costs that are inefficient. Then you keep more of what you make, then learn to grow your money. And the best way to grow is to figure out what your investor DNA is, what things you're good at, only investing there and creating cash flow with it, and then doing everything you can to protect that cash flow.
That's
the formula. All right, so billionairesmethod.com or cashflowbanking.com are two great resources. Now, you can turn your thoughts into profits and build a life you love.